So let's start. Hello everyone. My name is Daria, and can you hear me well? Yeah, okay. So I'm a full stack web developer at Theodo. Theodo is a Paris-based web consultancy agency, and we work with startups as well as big companies to help them launch new products or maintain their existing system or applications. And so the story I'm about to share with you during this talk happened on a project that we did for one of our big clients, and it all started 4 years ago when we first started to work with this big client and we developed the first website for them. The website had the following architecture. So there was a front end, which as it was in 2015 was in Angular, and we had a back end that did all the logic and all the processing. Which was composed of 6 microservices. At the time we used Flask, so maybe some of you know it. It's a Python framework for doing web applications. So we had these 6 microservices that were each living in its own repository. So just for more info, we were using, and we are still are using, Git and GitHub for our version control and code storage. So this gives us 6 microservices equals 6 repositories. Then we continued working for this same client, and we did another application for them. In order to satisfy all the functional requirements of this new application, we needed to enrich the backend with new microservices. So we added 4 of them. And we also started noticing that we were doing some code duplication. So there was same logic duplicated across several microservices. And as you know, it's not good to duplicate the code because it's hard to maintain and you risk to have bugs in it. So we decided to take it out and to move it to a separate repository that you see in yellow. So for example, stuff like indicating that a certain endpoint requires the user to be authenticated in order to access it, it goes to the shared logic. So this gave us 11 code repositories, and it did not end here because we continued working for this client. And today, taking into account all the applications we had to develop and all the new microservices we needed to develop these applications, we ended up with 30 microservices, so 31 code repository. And as you can imagine, we were quite overwhelmed by it. And we started to face some problems due to this code organization. So I'll walk you through the problems that we faced, but first, so that you are able to better understand why we faced them, I'll give you like a small tour of our branching strategy. Maybe you use the same, so it's quite simple. We have 2 main branches. We have a production branch that contains code that is shipped to production to the end users. And we have a pre-production branch that is deployed to a pre-production environment that is quite similar to the production, but that is not exposed to the users, so we can freely test our code on it before shipping it to the user. Each time a developer in my team needs to create a new feature, he creates his feature branch from the production. Then, once he is done coding, he makes what in GitHub is called a pull request. So it allows other team members to review his source code and comment on its quality to make some remarks. Once the pull request has been read by the code developers and approved, the developer can then merge the code into pre-production and test it. And once he's satisfied with the result, he can do the same for production branch. So he creates another pull request, and then he merges his code into production, thus shipping it to the end user. So, as you see, when we need to do one feature, we need to make at least 2 pull requests. And this simple fact is actually the cause of all the problems that we faced. Okay, so the first problem. I had one colleague who needed to do a functionality which relied on 3 microservices, so he needed to modify 3 microservices. And as you saw from our branching strategy, to do it, he needed to do 6 pull requests in total, so 2 for each microservice. He spent maybe 10 minutes doing it, so it's not critical, but I think creating pull requests is not the most interesting like part of being a developer. So that's it, and that's even not the biggest problem with having many pull requests, as there are a lot of pull requests lying around our repositories. Sometimes we forgot to merge some of them, and so we ship incomplete functionalities to production, and our end users face bugs in production, which is totally unacceptable. So that's the first problem. Then I had another nice colleague who wanted to improve so our developer experience. Maybe you know, as a developers, we really love to argue about coding style. So like, do I put two spaces or four spaces? When I declare my function, do I put all the arguments on one line or do I put them on each on single line? Like, I'm sure some of you discussed that. And so to stop these aimless discussions once and for all, this colleague made a meeting with all the developers, and we agreed on a code style standard that we wanted to enforce upon all the code base to never discuss it again. And so he installed a tool that actually checks that the code corresponds to the standard on one of the microservices. And as it needed to be the feature that was available on the whole code base, he needed to do it on all of them. And he spent 3 hours to do this simple change. I think he was quite tired and pissed off. So that's another problem. Then I had yet another colleague who also wanted to improve our lives of developers. And so he wanted to have his automated test results being printed like in a nice fancy way. So he found a tool for that, and you can see a demo of the tool here. He installed this tool on the microservice he was working on, so he was quite happy because he could benefit from it, but he didn't go further and he didn't spend 3 hours to create all the pull requests, so he was the only developer to benefit from it. So you see that sharing your experience with others is really complicated. And that's not all of the problems, though we have the biggest one at the end. So just to sum up, you see that our Git workflow prevented us from sharing our nice findings and improving our developer experience. And so the last problem is related to this shared logic repository that I talked to you at the beginning. Let's see how it actually works. We use a Git feature that is called a submodule to do it. And so what's a submodule? Does anyone use a submodule here? Ah, nice. Okay, so a submodule is a feature of Git that allows you to use one project inside of another project. So here you see two projects that are independent, the microservice and the shared logic. And you can say that a given version of the microservice uses the given version of the shared logic. And like this, actually, when you check out the code of microservice on your computer, you will have the shared logic code inside it. And then if the shared logic is further updated, you need to update your microservice to use the latest version of shared logic. And of course, each microservice can depend on its own version of shared logic, which adds some complexity. Now, imagine that you have a bug in this shared logic library. How do you fix it? Well, it's not a very pleasant process, because first you need to fix the bug in the shared logic. So you make your feature branch, you merge it in pre-production, then you, in the microservice, you need to tell that you are using this new version of shared logic that has no bug. Then you test the microservice in pre-production. Once it's okay, so it's green, it's okay, you merge the shared logic into production, and then yet again you update the microservice to point to the production version of shared logic, and you deploy it into production, and you're done. And then you need to do it 30 times because you have all your microservices that use the shared logic, and you need to update them all. So I think none of us would want to do it. So to sum up, we saw that this organization of our code, where we have each microservice in its own repository, is not optimal because the dependency management is quite hard. We need to do a lot of pull requests to do a simple feature. And also, in case we want to do a change that impacts the whole code base, we need to do like 30 pull requests or even 60, which is like it's impossible. And so we started to think which alternatives are there to this multi-repository structure. And we started to look at what big companies, big tech companies, so with large code bases do. How do they store their source code? And actually, if you look on the internet, you can find that Google, for example, he stores all his enormous code base in a single repository. So it's what we call a monorepository. It's like a code repository that stores several projects that may be not related to each other. And we saw that this monorepository concept was quite promising because even Google with his enormous code base with billions of lines and hundreds, thousands of contributions daily can handle all of this with a monorepository. And also we found out that the fact of using this monolithic monorepository code structure allowed Google to address several problems that are very similar to others. So it simplifies dependency management and code sharing. So hopefully we can solve our dependency help problem with this. And also it makes atomic changes and collaboration easier. So hopefully we can address the two other problems by migrating to a monorepository. So after some thinking, we decided to migrate all our code to a monorepository actually, and that's what I'll talk about in this presentation. So in order to perform a successful migration to a monorepository, we needed to find answers to several technical questions, which are the following. So first, we wanted to not simply copy paste all the code, but also keep the modification history for all the microservices, because me, for example, I like doing some archaeology and like looking why did we add this line of code, what was the idea behind, so it can be quite useful to keep the history. Also, we needed to ensure that after the migration, our continuous integration system was still fast. I'll give you more details later on this. Also, we needed to ensure that the deployment was still working so that we were still able to ship the features to end users, which is the like the goal of all of this. And we wanted to have visibility on the progress of our migration, so to know if we were taking too much time or not. And of course, we wanted to have zero bugs during this migration so that the final user is not impacted and doesn't notice anything. So let's see how we tackled the first problem. Here on the left, you see the initial structure of our multi-repository system. So you have each microservice, each API in its own repository, so with its source code that is in the SRC folder. And on the right, you see the final solution, final organization we want to have. So you see there's one single repository, which has a subfolder for each microservice. Okay, so how do we pass from the left to the right? First, we do some modifications in each microservice repository. So we change the structure of the folders to correspond to a target structure. So it's quite easy. So we create a new folder. We move all the source code to it. And then we commit the changes. And once this is done, so we can do the copy-paste in itself. So it's a nice trick that we found. This time we work in the monorepo, so actually we can add the like the local microservice as the remote to the monorepo, and like this we can merge the master branch of the microservice into the master branch of the monorepo. This allows us to transfer all the files and also to transfer all the history of the microservice. And what's interesting here is this allow unrelated histories option. So normally, when you do a git merge, you cannot merge together like two histories that have no common points, which was the case for us. But if you specify, if you add this allow unrelated histories option, you can actually do it. So this is what does the trick for us. So once we found how to migrate one microservice, we automated this process. So you can see that it's basically six lines of code, but it's not interesting to do it 30 times manually. It takes time, and you can like make a typo or make an error, and you will have bugs. So automation is always a good option. It allows you to go faster and have no bugs. Yay, so we removed all the code and we kept the history. Now we needed to ensure that the continuous integration was still fast enough for us. But first, I'm sure like all of you know what a continuous integration is, and I hope you all use it on your projects. But a quick reminder so that we're on the same page and you understand what I'll talk about. So continuous integration is a development practice in which developers push their code daily to a common repository, so they don't keep it on their computer for months and months. And also the code is automatically checked after each push. So why is it interesting? For two reasons. It allows you to detect bugs early, so just after they were introduced. And because of this, you can easily fix them, so you're more productive, and yeah, that's it. So in our case, the continuous integration system, the second part that checks the code using an automated build, consisted of two steps. We ran some automated unit tests, and we did some checks on the code style. And this CI was run at three points in the development process. So the first one, it's after the developer pushed his code to a common repository, and before he is able to merge it in pre-production. Then the CI was run after the merge into pre-production was run to was done to ensure that the code was still okay. And finally, after the merge into production, the CI was also run. So when we had just one microservice per repository, the CI took 5 minutes to execute. It gave us enough time to go grab a coffee. And you can imagine if we have 30 microservices in a single repository, the CI will take 30 times more time. So that makes a lot of coffee to drink. And it's also, I think, quite unacceptable because like you have nothing to do during like 30% of your working day, so it's not optimal. And so this was certainly a problem that we needed to address. As we didn't want to reinvent the wheel, we started looking for existing tools to handle this problem in monorepositories. And there are quite a lot of them. So you have Lerner, which is very practical if you have a JavaScript library that you are editing. And there are other that are used by famous tech companies. And actually, these tools are quite powerful. Maybe they are even too powerful for our use case. So finally, I ended up by reinventing the wheel and coding my own tool to handle the continuous integration execution. And it's actually not that hard, so I was able to do it like in 4 hours. The continuous integration system that I imagined had two steps. So first, this is like the step that holds all the intelligence. We need to determine which microservices were modified. So these are the microservices we need to check and not the others. And then once this is done, so we launch the continuous integration builds for these modified microservices. So let's see how we did the first step. For this, we got some inspiration from the Lerner tool that I mentioned earlier. At Lerner, they use what's called a tag to handle the versioning and CI management. So what's a tag? It's another Git concept that allows you to mark a certain point in your commit history as being important. And so basically a tag has two properties. A tag also always points to a commit, and a tag has a name. So here you can see we have a history with three commits, and each of them has a tag, tag one, tag two, tag three. And so how do we use these tags to optimize our continuous integration system? Well, the idea is to automatically put a tag onto the production branch each time that we detect a change in a microservice. So let me walk you through the whole process. We start at the beginning with all the microservices being at first version. So imagine we have only three microservices in our repository. So we will have on the first commit three tags. So A, V1, B, V1, and C, V1 to indicate the first version. Then after some changes are done to the A repository, to A microservice, we need to bump its version. So on the second commit where the A is modified, we add a AV2 tag. Then when we have B microservice that is modified, we add a BV2 tag. And then imagine there is a developer so who starts working on his new functionality. He creates his feature branch. And meanwhile, his other team members continue working. And so they update the C microservice. And so there is another commit in the production branch where we create, which we mark with a CV2 tag. Once the developer is done with his feature, he's ready to merge it into pre-production or production, so it's similar in this case. And we need to know which microservices do we need to test on his feature branch. So it's the same thing as saying which microservices were modified on his feature branch. So let's see how we determine this. So we will check which microservices actually were modified since the last accessible tag. So the accessible tags, they're situated on the blue line, as you can understand. So for example, we start with the A microservice. We find its last accessible tag, so it's AV2, that is orange. We compare the two versions of A, so we see if there were any changes done to it. Suppose that there were, okay, so we note it. Then we do the same thing for B, so we check if it was modified since the last tag. So let's suppose it was not. And then finally we do the same thing for C. So here it's an important point, as we only look at accessible tags. We do not check the CV2 tag because it's not accessible from the from the feature we are coming from. And so let's suppose the C microservice was also modified. Well, in this case, the first step is done, and now all that remains is to launch the continuous integration for A and C microservices. And also, in case we are in, it was the merge into production branch, we need to automatically tag this new commit to indicate that there were some changes to A and C. So we create two tags in order for the system to continue working. Oof, so that's it. We managed to keep the continuous integration fast enough. So we just added 2 minutes due to this first step. But there was still some problem. So you remember this shared logic? Well, in case we modify shared logic, as it's used by all other microservices, we need to test everything. And so this leaves us with 2 hours, 30 minutes of build time. Fortunately, there is another solution for it. It's parallelization. So the idea is that instead of executing all the steps of your continuous integration build one by one, you can identify the steps that are independent, and you can run them in parallel. So if your CI provider or CI infrastructure has enough resources, you can launch 30 steps at once, and you will have still 7 minutes and not 3 hours of execution. So this, I think, was the hardest point of our migration. The rest will be a little bit easier. We needed to ensure that the deployment was still working, so that we could still ship to users from this monorepository. And so luckily for us, our deployment process was already following best practices. So two of them, it was automated, so there was no developer or ops like doing all the steps one by one. And we had a rollback strategy, meaning that if deployment failed or if we deployed some code with bugs, we had a simple way just to click on a button and have the previous version being deployed. So this was quite useful because to adapt the deployment process for the monorepository, we simply needed to change the deployment script to tell him to like go fetch the code in the monorepository instead of like a certain repository, and that's it. So it was really easy to do. And then, so we succeeded to tackle the three big technical questions, and this allowed us to actually start the migration. So as I told you, we are at Theodo, we are a consultancy agency, meaning that we work for our clients to develop like products for them. So we have a certain degree of accountability, and we need to show them like the progress that we make in developing our features. And in case of migration to monorepository, we need to inform the client on the volume of work that was done to show him that everything goes well or not. So we needed to keep this in mind, and also we needed to make sure we make no mistake and we do not impact the final user by introducing some bugs. So for this, we used a concept that is called a progressive rollout. I'll show you what it means just after. And as you noticed, so we really like homemade tools, so we imagined yet another tool that we made to implement this progressive rollout. So this tool was a spreadsheet where on the top row you can see all the steps that we need to do in order to migrate one microservice to a monorepository. So you can see that we start by warning the developers that the migration is started. Then we close the repository to make it read-only. Then like we move all the code to monorepository, we check that CI passes. We update the deployment process, then we deploy into pre-production, we test, and then we deploy to production, and then this is done. And so in the first column, you have all the microservices we needed to migrate. So we started by migrating a fake microservice. It's actually like any other microservice, but so it has the same like database. I don't know, it uses the same dependencies, but it's not exposed to the final users. And this like test microservice allows us to do anything we want with it and be able to test it in a production environment without the users noticing. So once we migrated this test microservice successfully, we proceeded to migrate all the remaining ones. And by following this progressive rollout plan, with a nice spreadsheet tool, we were able to do the migration with zero bugs in production. I think it's quite remarkable. Okay, so the migration was done, but did it really solve any of the problems we had? To know the answer, it's like the most logical thing is to go ask the developers themselves. So that's what I did. You remember this guy who needed to create a lot of pull requests to implement his feature? Well, this was no longer the case. As you can see, so with the monorepository organization, we needed at maximum two pull requests for any feature we want. And this was really appreciated by all the technical team. And also, you may remember this other developer who wanted to enforce a consistent code style upon all the code base, and who spent 3 hours on doing it. Well, after the migration, he had another nice idea. So he's quite a fan of code style, so he wanted to add a tool that would update your files to format them according to the the style standard each time you do some modifications and you save the file. So like this, we know that the code style is always okay. So he simply installed a tool that did it on the monorepository, and instead of spending 3 hours to do it as it was the case with multi-repository, he only spent 10 minutes. So I think he quite appreciated it. So to sum up, we went from having 30 microservices with 30 repositories to still having 30 microservices, but this time in a monorepository. And this allowed us to have a lighter Git workflow, which in turn enabled us to be more productive. So as we didn't spend so much time creating pull requests, we were able to ship features more fast to our developers. And we were also able to easily add new tools that improved our developer experience. And all of this allowed us to ship better products to our clients. And so what about you? Maybe on some of your projects, as you use microservices, you have the same problems, like the dependencies are really hard to manage, the internal dependencies that you develop. Or maybe when you need to do like a feature that depends on several microservices, maybe you need to do a lot of pull requests. Or maybe each time you want to do like a small change across the whole code base, you need to spend 3 hours doing it, even though it takes like actually 10 minutes. Well, if you're facing some of these problems, maybe a monorepository can be a solution for you. And in case you decide to try it, I advise you to keep so these three important points in mind. First, make sure you keep all your change history, because it may be useful in the future if you want to analyze something. Then make sure that the continuous integration is fast. Or if you like really like drinking coffee, you can keep it slow, but maybe maybe not. Don't be ashamed to try a homemade solution, because your use case may be really simple, and you may be able to address it yourself without using like an enormous solution from the market. And finally, make sure that the deployment works. Otherwise, you won't be able to ship anything to your users. And I think this is like the reason of why we do what we do, to ship features to our users. And so for this, what really helps is to follow best practices for development, so automated for deployment, so automated deployment process, rollback strategy, and you can find others. And finally, as you saw, the migration consists of like many simple steps. And we may think that we are developers, we are really intelligent, so we just can keep them in our head and do them one by one. But don't be ashamed to use a checklist. So it's quite effective to not forget anything. Thank you. So to do this migration, we had it. Yeah, the question was, how much time did it take to do the migration from multi-repository to monorepository? So we had a team of like one developer for 1 week and like one developer for 3 days. So it's like 10 man days with not so senior developers. So like 10 days or maybe even 5 days if you are like senior. So that's it. And I think with this plan, so you don't need to find answers to some of the questions that we needed to answer. So it may be even like faster. So I think it's a week or two.
Do you think there is an interest to merge into a monorepository some repository in different language?
Okay, so the question is it interesting to have a monorepository that have projects that use different languages?
Yes.
Yeah, I think absolutely. So as you saw at Google, they use a monorepository, and I'm sure that they have more than one language that is used. So it means that it's viable. And also, I really do not see any constraints that would prevent you from doing it. Because the fact that you have a monorepository, so it does not change anything in the logic of your microservices. You just simply store them together, store the source code together, but their logic remains independent. So yeah, certainly you can do it.
Have you run into any issues around having multiple people having pull requests to the same repo? Because we have a repository that we tend to have quite a few developers changing at once. It's not a mono repository, but we already have problems where the pull requests stack up because people can't review them fast enough.
Yeah.
And I was thinking with 30 microservices, if you have 30 changes, one to each one in a day, how do you manage that?
So just to check that I understood correctly, you wonder if the fact that we have a mono repository and a lot of contributions, causes some problems in the due to many pull requests being open. So it was like a bit of a problem, but we are maybe 15 developers working on this whole structure. So it was never really an issue. Like, you can have a list of say 20 pull requests at any given time, but then you can use the filtering. So GitHub offers filtering, I think, by the author of pull requests, so you can filter by author, and also you can add custom tags to each to pull requests, so then you can filter by tags. So I think it can be a problem, but if you use the filtering, it's okay.
Hello, thank you for the talk. I saw that you say that there were 15 developers.
Yep.
Are they structured in teams, separate teams, or all in the same one?
Okay, so the question is, we have 15 developers working on this microservice system. Are they structured in teams, or like, are they working all together? So at Theodo, we have a certain methodology for team organization. We always have a team that has like one lead developer and from one to four junior developers. And so in this case, we also had, I think, three or four teams working on the whole microservice system. And the way the teams were split is each team was working on the certain like domain topic for this big client. And so, yes, we had multiple teams, and each team needed to like had its own microservices on which it worked often. And you can have several teams that work on the same.
And thus the following question is, did the change to monorepo change somehow the way the team communicated the proposal of changes and so, like, did it change the flow of decisions?
The flow, so you ask if the migration to monorepository changed the way the team communicated and the...
usually one team, when there's microservices, one team has ownership on certain microservices. Mm-hmm. And doing pull requests on that, it's a thing that they feel like they have to review. Maybe this feeling has been is lost, or it's does it affect you in a practical way?
As you say, we had a concept of a team that is responsible for microservice, because the logic can be quite complex and we can't all know each microservice perfectly. So you had some developers who knew better than others the microservice, and in this case, if you made a significant update to a microservice, you needed to request a review from this person. But as all the microservices were put into the same container, this actually, I think it improved the sharing of the knowledge of the logic. But we still kept this this team responsible for this microservice logic.
Okay, thank you.
Is there an owner for the monorepo, and who is in charge of tagging and deciding when is it done?
Yeah, so is there someone who decides when to tag? The tagging process that you saw, so when we update a microservice and we put a tag to indicate the bump of the version, it's done automatically. So actually, each time there is a change that is merged into production, the tag is done automatically, and then the code is also deployed automatically. So there is no manual intervention to launch the deployment, as we use what is, I think, called continuous delivery. So the code is deployed automatically. We don't need someone to decide when we are ready. Other questions?
Yeah. It looks like some of your problems seem to be caused by a cumbersome Git branching strategy. At any point during the migration, did you consider trunk-based development?
Okay, so the question is if we considered using trunk-based development. So just let me check that I understand correctly what it is. So you have the trunk and your develop branch, and you merge all features into develop, and then you like do a one single merge into trunk when you want to do a release, right?
Yeah. Or simply put, you commit directly to trunk or to master, mm-hmm. and you have CI tools ensure a level of quality. So
that we
go straight into master. If it does not pass any quality checks, then it would be automatically rolled back, and there would be no pull requests.
Yeah, I think, no, we did not consider it. Like, I don't remember why, but I think it can be a good strategy also to, if you see that your branching strategy is not doing it for you, I think you can totally consider what you suggested, like to have one main branch and have the automated like process that rejects pull requests. But unfortunately, so we didn't consider it. And besides, so it was quite fun migrating to the monorepository, so.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
My question is about the challenges we have when we move to one repository, mm-hmm. and if there is any challenges in managing the access for teams,
yeah.
and like the question that was posed before is, how we can manage the access and mm-hmm. the review process mm-hmm. or the review ownership in one repository.
Okay.
It was an easy way when we have a multiple repository, but in one repository, what is the strategy?
Yeah. Okay, so the strategy for managing access to certain microservices, so to certain code, depends on the version control system that you use. So in our case, we were using GitHub. And GitHub allows to set up access rules for each repository, but inside the repository you cannot set access rules on each folder. So the monorepository is either fully accessible to someone or not accessible at all. And this was actually a problem because we had some microservices that were confidential, so we couldn't grant the access to like any developer. And these microservices remained outside of the monorepository because GitHub does not allow us these file-based access rules. But maybe other tools like what do you have, GitLab, Bitbucket, and maybe other they allow it. I know that at Google, so they had the resources to build their own version control system in which they surely have this file-based access. But in our case, no, we didn't. So for microservices that are confidential, they stayed out of the monorepository, unfortunately.
Thank you.
Well, no more questions. And if you want to discuss the monorepository, feel free to come and talk. Thanks.